Welcome everyone. I want to welcome three esteemed guests, Natalia Washington from Washington University in St. Louis, Daniel Kelly from Purdue University, and Stephen Stich from Rutgers. Today we're going to talk about a variety of topics at the intersection of philosophy and psychology, trying to understand how to kind of do productive and rich interdisciplinary work. And so I thought to start, perhaps each of you could tell the audience a little bit about, you know, what are some of the kind of research topics that you find most personally compelling?
So I guess I'm interested in kind of two broad questions. The first is about individual differences and how differences between people with respect to maybe how their minds or brains work or with how they're situated with their environments underlie ways of being healthy or well versus ill. I do a lot of work in philosophy and psychiatry, so I'm interested in mental illness both as a kind of normative concept as well as the sort of mental disorder kind of descriptive concept, so how we're going to taxonomize these various psychiatric categories in the sciences, and then how those get deployed in, I guess, popular culture or in the news media, and how these things then get taken up in common discussion. And I'm also interested in just sort of broadly how much of the mind is constituted by maybe or grounded in environment interaction. So how we are as knowers or as agents is helped or hindered by the social, epistemic, or cultural context we find ourselves in.
Yeah, so my interests are very broadly at the intersection of cognitive science and philosophy of mind and moral theory. I've always just been interested in humans and how they tick, and particularly how they evolved and why we're such weird outliers in the natural world. And a lot of my research, the more specific things stem out of that. So I've done work on the way different emotions play into and shape moral judgments, and then the social interactions, which are their oftentimes their subject matter. Done work on the ways that biases can take explicit and implicit form, and then how we should map on our current practices of holding ourselves responsible for various actions onto this sort of weird set of attitudes or biases people might have that don't easily fit into the intuitive categories that folk moral theory often work with. And recently I've been thinking a lot about the way culture and biological evolution have interacted in the case of humans, and how a picture of what morality might be comes out of that, which is a little bit different than the standard, the usual suspects of it's all about cooperation based on reciprocity or based on kinship, but it's more about something having to do with group selection and social norms and normative cognition in that sense.
Well, I can give you the easy answers. I'm interested in what Ben's interested in. In the psychological and neurological mechanisms underlying morality and normativity more generally, and how they came to be, what their evolutionary history is, and then what that can tell us, if anything, about substantive moral debates, whether they're moves that look inappropriate against the background of the underlying cognitive and neurological mechanisms, and other moves that look more appropriate against the background of those mechanisms.
It's a really nice way to put that. Like that.
I mean, one fascinating common thread across what all three of you said was, you know, thinking about the intersection between philosophical and normative considerations and, you know, various results we see from the biological or social sciences or clinical sciences. And I guess What do you think about how, you know, your work is informed by that work? And, you know, what do you see as the appropriate relationship between kind of empirical results and normative theorizing?
I'll take a go at it. I doubt there's going to be just one appropriate relationship. I think there's a bunch of different ones, and then they, you know, one of my hobby horses is we need to bring a lot more specificity and think not in global, extremely general terms like philosophers tend to about what are the implications of evolutionary theory for morality. We need to get much more specific about carving off different chunks and thinking about what different cognitive mechanisms might be informing moral theory in different ways. But it, even just more generally, so one thing you might do as a philosopher, well, there's a number of things you might do as a philosopher, you might actually be contributing to empirical literature by gathering data. That's a thing now. Experimental philosophy is a well-recognized subdiscipline. You might be doing philosophy of science, where what you're doing isn't gathering data or thinking directly about the world itself. You're thinking about how science works, and you're trying to maybe make normative claims about how evidence should be brought to bear on theories or what the reasonable criteria of theory selection is. But then, this is from Peter Godfrey Smith, has recoined this term, philosophy of nature, where you're thinking about the world again, but you're thinking about it through the lens of science. And I think that is really where a lot of my work most comfortably fits, that I'm not gathering data, I'm not doing philosophy of science, but I'm using science to try and inform how I'm thinking about philosophic questions.
Probably something that we all share in common, that questions that we find very interesting require good theoretical or normative investigation and good empirical work, that you can't answer a question like, what do we do in a situation where doctors might be biased by gift-giving or something like that, by focusing solely on some high-level normative theory or focusing solely on some kind of empirical research, that it's really the two together. Even though it's hard, interdisciplinary work is the hard work, but I think the genuine stuff. I know I was really influenced by a paper that Steve wrote with John Doris, sort of telling philosophers that they need to take the empirical claims that they make more seriously, by which they mean like be savvy consumers of science and think clearly about what you can say and what you can't say in the empirical domain.
Yeah, well, to pick up on both these themes, there the work that I alluded to with John Doris is a kind of example where what we did is look at some of the claims that philosophers have made about what was required to be realistic about ethics, to think that there really are true and false answers to moral questions. And a number of the so-called moral realists in philosophy had put forward claims about the kinds of disagreements that you could and could not find or should and should not be able to find if, in fact, this view of moral realism, that there are right and wrong answers to moral questions, was correct. And these just struck us as obviously empirical questions, which philosophers shouldn't be simply speculating about. And we went out and looked at the evidence and built an argument based on the existing anthropological evidence. And in fact, also gathered some of our own. So increasingly, I've been involved in data collection with big projects looking at many different cultures around the world to ask how similar and different are the moral systems you find in different cultures. And what does that tell us about the plausibility or implausibility of a bunch of views in moral theory? But another thing I wanted to say here is that I've also been very influenced by Dan's work. He was being quite modest, I think, about what he's shown. That Dan has been looking, there's a large literature that Dan has participated in about the role of disgust in moral judgment making. And there's no question but that disgust plays a role in moral judgment making. And the hard question is, well, what do we do about that fact? Why does it play this role? How did the emotion of disgust get intertwined with all the other mechanisms that are used that ultimately produce moral judgments? And what can we learn from that history? And Dan has been one of the leaders in arguing that, well, once we understand how that came to be, we can see that although it made perfectly good sense from an evolutionary point of view, it's something we should guard against. And that's one of the, I think, the most powerful ways in which the kind of empirical work that all three of us are interested in can impact on substantive issues in moral theory.
Now, you all work at the intersection of philosophy and psychology and other fields, aiming at kind of social questions that have clear practical ramifications, impact on important everyday examples and issues. I mean, how do you see your work as informing, or how does empirically informed philosophy, how does it speak to hot-button social issues? How does it relate to the public? What do you see your role as kind of shaping social and public discourse?
Okay, I'll go. I actually think news media sources can take the title of a social psychological paper and draw some grand conclusions that authors never intended. That these kinds of dangers put us in a specific spot, I guess, as an epistemic resource or as influencers or something like that. And I think because we are in this position, we, as philosophers of science, or maybe just as academics in general, should think carefully about how to use that in the right way, because it's going to be done, like whether or not we think about steering it. Okay? One thing we can do besides, try and tell people interesting things about the way the world is, like, did you know that when you're discussed, mechanisms are recruited in this way when you're making this kind of decision, is to sort of help people sort of expand their comfort zone with respect to what are reasonable ways of thinking. It's not really like a fight against those who are reasoners and those who aren't reasoners, but against two groups of reasoners who are starting from very different backgrounds or have different theoretical apparatuses that they're used to working with. And that's something that I'd like to address.
But just how it can help guide maybe crafting of policies to help social justice or help address inequality or something. I mean, the kind of cliche I always fall back on is if you want to save the world, you got to know which levers to pull. And so even with something that seems so obvious to us, like the way our minds work, it seems so transparent. We have this tradition coming from Descartes that if there's anything you know, it's the contents of your own mind. But that just turns out to be false, as we've learned from, 40, 50 years of cognitive science, and it turns out to be false when it comes to morality as well. So just figuring out and sort of consolidating and making more consumable the lessons that have come from a lot of this work about the ways in which maybe you should not just have a knee-jerk trustworthiness towards your own gut feelings a lot of the time. I think that's one way that it can help. This the idea of a nudge is something which has gotten a lot of public traction recently, and which nudges are going to work and which nudges aren't going to work is something that people like philosophers can think about if they're trying to draw implications from the empirical work. And in terms of ethics, it's not necessarily addressing the traditional view of like what's the right thing to do or what's the ideal setup here. It's more of a ethics of transition, like how can we get things moving in the right direction, even if we haven't decided exactly what the perfect situation is. How can we more effectively instigate social change or get people to accept more reasonable policies about gun laws or environmental protection things?
For some of your other work on the ethics of implicit bias, so if you are generally aware that people have these implicit social gender and stereotype racial biases, I mean, what is the ethical impetus on us to kind of become aware of those biases and try to work against them?
Yeah, and just developing a vocabulary and figuring out the best way that you can make people aware of the widespread existence of these things without thereby putting them on the defensive and, just increasing awareness and giving people a vocabulary with which to think about this is a huge first step.
Well, I'm particularly interested in diversity and its limits, and to what extent informing people about the existence of this diversity will change what they actually do. I have no good idea, but I've been focusing for the last decade or so on looking at some of that diversity. So we run projects that explore moral convictions. The most recent one was in 23 countries using 18 different languages. And with another group of collaborators, we've been looking at people in small-scale societies and discovered really remarkable instances, surprising instances of diversity. The most exciting one recently, a paper we recently published, indicates that in many small-scale societies, in three or four that we looked at, a number of small-scale societies, the role of the agent's intention, whether the agent, for example, intended to harm the person that he actually harmed or whether it was an accident, which looms so absolutely central in the moral systems that we're aware of in the West. In a number of cultures, it looks to be the case that the agent's intention is irrelevant. And that there are moral systems like that would, one would hope, get people to step back and ask about themselves. Is there a good reason to do it my way rather than to do it that way? Or are these alternative good ways of organizing the society and a system of norms? So that's the real motive for my cross-cultural work is getting people to realize the enormous diversity there and occasionally finding, as we sometimes do, surprising universal.
Well, thank all three of you. Thank you for that. That was, I think all three of your work, I mean, I think it nicely illustrates kind of the rich possibilities that exist when we try to think across traditional boundaries of philosophy or psychology. And so I appreciate all of your input here today, and thanks for joining us.
Thanks for having us.